Hey, what is up everyone? Norman from Future Student University here, and welcome to another video in our JSON series. In the first few videos, we have looked at how you can add JSON to your project and how JSON deals with nested objects. In this video, we will look at another important part of objects, lists and arrays. If you want to code along, you can find the code on our website. It's the first link in the description below. Before we start coding, let's think about the concept between lists and arrays for a little bit. Now, the Java implementation for lists or arrays are significantly different, and both have their advantages and disadvantages. And based on that, what we're going to apply for our implementation kind of depends on the use case and also on our personal preference. But the interesting thing is when it comes to JSON and JSONs, it doesn't really matter, because from a conceptual standpoint, arrays and lists are the same thing. It's just a list of object. It's just a different Java implementation for it. So in JSON, there's no difference between arrays or lists. It's represented the exact same way. So on a high level, when I say lists in this video, I could mean both. It doesn't really matter. There are a few implementation details we will look at, and hopefully this will become more clear as we go along in this video. So let's jump into code. So last time we had that restaurant model, which had the name and it also had like the owner and two staffs. Now let's remove that nested object part because it's not relevant to this video and instead add a list. And we're just going to say it's a list of menu items for the restaurant, right? So let's call this items. Now we need to implement the restaurant menu item class, and let's just add a string here again, the name, and maybe a float for change, which is going to be the price, even though float is not the best for representing prices, but this is really just a small example. And obviously this is Java utilist. Now, obviously, this is not a complete restaurant model. We don't have any side dishes or combos. It's just to show you how JSON deals with a list of objects. Last time, we've always created a JSON by hand and then created one by JSON to see its exact same thing. But I think by now we can trust JSON that it always creates a valid JSON. So I think let's go into our main class here and start the serialization of our new model. So first of all, let's create the restaurant menu item. And I forgot it's an inner class. Maybe I need to make this public. Well, let's make it static too. Nope, still no. Okay, let's see. There you go. And let's make this an array list. All right, let's add some items to it. Say a steak, since we are a steakhouse. For 20 units. I'm guessing we obviously need to make new. Can't forget that. And I will also need to create a constructor. That was a fail. All right, let's go back and maybe create a couple more. Maybe we have also some noodles and maybe for the vegetarians, the salad. Salad is a little bit cheaper, and the spaghetti are the cheapest. All right, now we need to create our restaurant model overall. So let's say new restaurant. And I don't think we have a constructor here again. So let's create that. And say and we are going to pass the menu items. Okay, this is our restaurant. So let's see what happens when we serialize this object. Now, as you remember from last time, we just need a new JSON instance. And then we can say to JSON to get our JSON. Okay, let's execute this. All right, so we got our JSON down here, and let's copy this to a JSON file so we can make it look nice. And as we see up here, we have the name object or the name property, and that is as expected. And nested, we have the items, also like we expected. But here we see that the square brackets indicate an array. And in that array, we have three objects. Now the objects are indicated by the curly brackets. It's incredibly important that you understand the difference between the square brackets, which just say here's an array incoming, and the curly brackets, which say here's an object. Now if you have an array full of custom objects like we have here, you have both of them mixed. So make sure you understand what happens when. The restaurant menu items are just like the name, the price, and everything is just like we expected. And we see that the float numbers are no problem either. Now, what I'm not going to do is how this would change if we use an array instead of a list. You just have to trust me on this one, is the exact same result as I have explained in the beginning. What I do want to show you is what happens when the list is the root element. Right now we had a nested list in the restaurant object, but what happens when we pass the menu items as an object instead of the restaurant? Let's find out. All right, obviously the JSON got smaller. Here you can see that the JSON starts with the square brackets. So it's indicating right away our root element is now an array. It is not a custom object anymore, it's right away an array. And in that array, we have three custom objects. So no matter if it's a root element array or if the array or list is nested in an object, JSON does it without any more configuration. It's just the regular to JSON call. Fantastic. So let's close these things and go into the other direction. So going from a JSON with some array information to the Java objects. So let's stop this part. And we will jump into this in a second. Now what we're going to look at is an example JSON you might get from an endpoint. So this is the imaginary endpoint get all founders of Future Studio, which is Christian, Marcus and me. And also a count on how many flowers or plants we have on our desk. Now in this video I've also learned that Marcus likes to work in a jungle. So let's try to convert this into Java objects. So what we need to do is create some Java models which cover this. So let's create a new Java class which we're going to call founder. And let's move this over there. And then we can see we have two properties. We have a string, which is a name, as pretty much always. And then we have an integer, which is the flower count. Actually, we can leave that like that and jump into our main class right here. We can close this again. And here we have the same JSON just as a string, so it's easier for us. And we don't have to do some Java IO stuff, which would just blow up the code. So let's do new JSON. And as always, we do from JSON. Now we pass the founder JSON. And now here it becomes interesting. We have the founder class, or the founder model, but that's only one out of the three, right? We have the founder 1, 2, and 3 times. So what we expect is not a single founder class, it's an array or a list of founders. So let's do the array first. What we can do is say, well, we don't expect a founder class, we expect the founder array class. And let's save these. Let's see if JSON can do the mapping automatically. All right, we see we have the founders array that has 3 objects in it. And the first one is Christian with a flower count of 1, so that worked. And we have Marcus with a jungle. And we have myself with just 2 flowers. Basically, when you have an array or list of objects in JSON, you can simply use the same function call from JSON and pass a JSON string. And then you can say it's a founder array class of that, and everything works as expected. So let's keep that in mind. Unfortunately, due to the Java language design, it becomes a little more complicated when you talk about lists due to the generics. So I'm going to show you how you can do the same thing if it's a list and not an array. Now, intuitively, you would hope that it's simply this, right? But that doesn't work like that. So what we have to do is we have to use a type token. So what does that mean? So what that means is we have to evaluate what is the type of the list of founders. And when we pass a type, JSON can do the mapping automatically. So we can say, okay, this is the founder list type. And this is flicked, okay. And we can evaluate the type with the type token class, which is provided by JSON. So we can simply say this is an array list, for example, and it's of the type founder. And now it gets a little funky, but you can copy and paste that pretty much into all of your classes. It's always going to be the same. And we pass a type. So let me show you that it works. Now, instead of the array, we have now an array list, and we have the 3 objects again with the same values. So what is happening here? Here we're saying, give me the type of an array list of founders. We get the type, and then we pass the type to JSON. And JSON can use that type to map from JSON to the list. Looks a little bit complicated when you see it the first time, but you will get used to it. The next thing I want to show you is when the list or the array is not the root element. Here we had, as you can see from the square bracket, it's the root element is a list. So let's look at the fsinfo JSON. So this is another endpoint which doesn't really exist, but let's just assume the server responds with this JSON. And the first character is the curly bracket, which you have learned is a custom object. Then we have some properties, and here the founders is again the same thing we have just seen, but the square bracket shows us it's a list. Let's start to map this object here into Java. So we will need another class. Let's call general info. And we have the name, we have the website, and then our founders. So I think we can remember this name, website, and then the founders. And the founders are an array or list. And it's the same thing we have just seen. So if we can simply use list founder. Okay, let's go to our deserialized class and switch it up. So now we have the general info JSON. Again, it's the same thing you just seen, just as a Java string. We can skip this. Let's take that away for now and update this part. Now you might be wondering, do I have to take this type token approach even if the list is nested? And no, you don't. You only have to use a type token approach when the list is a root element of your JSON. So here we can just say it's our general info class. And obviously we have to change the type up here. And I guess a variable is not the best name for it. And everything should be mapped correctly this way. All right, so we have our general info object and we have the name and the website. And we have founder is null. And let's see why that is. We have founders here with an S, and here is the S missing. So that's why the mapping didn't work. The names always have to be exact same. In the future video, we will look at how you can adjust these little name differences. So let's see if it works now. Yes, we have our founders, it's three objects, and everything is mapped correctly. Now, of course, you could change this into an array. And you don't have to change anything here. Again, it's a nested property, so you don't have to do anything. And our founders are all three still here. One last thing I want to mention is if you have a list or an array and that object, so that object in the list, hasn't a list in itself, so basically nested lists, that's no problem at all either. So you can nest as much objects as you want, you can nest as many lists as you want, you can nest lists in objects and so on. JSON can do everything automatically with the one exception when you want to map a general list like here, you have to use a type token approach. So let's review for a second. So you have seen that arrays or lists are only Java implementation detail and it doesn't really matter in JSON. Serialization of arrays or lists is absolutely no problem at all for JSON. Also, deserializing arrays is no problem. The only thing you have to be aware of is if you deserialize a root element list to an array list or a linked list. In the next video, we will look at what happens when you map null values. Thanks for watching. We appreciate you being here. And give the video a thumbs up if you've learned something. Also, subscribe if you want to see more videos in this series. Enjoy coding and make it rock!